you start again, please?
Cut!
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we are happy to have with us Nicolas Rojas, who has joined our group with a fellowship from the Chilean government, and he's going to tell us about flavors of neutrino physics and other herbs.
Yes, thank you, Jesse. Thank you for that nice introduction. Well, as Jesse has recently said, my name is Nicolas Rojas, and not Rojas as it was as it was entitled in the email, but it doesn't matter. I am a PhD from Pontificia Universidad Católica de Chile, and here I am doing my second postdoc after a short stay in Chile also. And my talk is called The Flavors of Neutrino Physics and the Other Herbs. And it basically is heavily based on two of my main topics of my thesis. First, I will do a very brief introduction about neutrino oscillations, as the physics we are interested in fit with our models. Secondly, I will do a first review about bilinear pipe dilation and a way to give rise to radiative neutrino masses. Afterwards, I will talk about the scotogenic model that was performed during my first stay here in Valencia. And finally, I will talk about other works that I am doing jointly with during this time. First, the history of neutrinos is quite close to the history of the standard model. However, they are proposed as they have been proposed as massless particles. Nevertheless, the experiments show a phenomenon that this is difficult to explain if we take massless neutrinos, which is the Fermi oscillation mechanism. For instance, in a world with just two neutrino flavors, we can perform a mixing into mass eigenstates. The Fermi states are labeled with the Latin index J, and the mass eigenstates are labeled with the Greek index J. We may compute the probability from going to one flavor of neutrino to the two other different. And it is given by the equation 2 in this fictitious work. And the probability from going from one flavor to the two other different is given by the mixing angle for neutrino flavors, and also, and more importantly, the frequency of the oscillation between flavors is given by the square mass difference of the mass eigenstates. At the present time, we know three neutrino flavors, and the neutrino oscillation physics is reduced to two square mass difference, one which involves an explanation for the former solar problem, another which is related to the former atmospheric problem, and also it includes three mixing angles. The homogeneous parametrization which mixes these three flavors is given by the equation 3, regardless if evaluating phases, they haven't been measured up to this day. And this parametrization consists of three mixing angles which are labeled by the mass eigenstate they are mixing. In this case, we are, in other words, we have the so-called atmospheric mixing angle, the solar mixing angle, and the reactor mixing angle. Now, we will do a large jump into supersymmetry. which for our purposes can be defined as a symmetry which includes the same degrees of freedom for fermions and bosons. In order to go into the minimal supersymmetric extension, which explains the standard model, one also has to include a new Hadock symmetry, which is called a parity, and it depends on the Baryon number, the lepton number, and the spin for each of the particles of the model. Therefore, this number is 1 for the standard model particles and minus 1 for the the corresponding supersymmetric particles. Nevertheless, one can violate our parity bilinearly by including these two terms, the first one in the square potential and the second one in the soft potential, which are showing a bilinear product of fields, which consists of the lepton superfield in the superpotential term and the Higgs up superfield, and this parameter epsilon, which is giving us a measure about how violated is this quantity of parity. In principle, we can think that numbers as small parameters, but in the practice there are works that that are not forbidding the largeness of this parameter. The consequences of introducing these terms thus, well, as it has been advanced, are pretty violated by the lepton number in one unit. Now, since the vacuum state is not invariant under this symmetry, all the scalar particles neutral in all their quantum numbers, but a lepton number, are able to acquire waves. So, its neutrinos are able to acquire waves. And another consequence, and which is important for us, is that fields with lepton number equal to 0 and lepton number equal to 1 are allowed to mix in mass eigenstates. And therefore, we can have a mix between neutrinos and neutralinos in mass eigenstates.
Regarding the magnitude of the epsilon, in practice, if you choose this model to account for the observed neutrino mass, epsilon must be more or less small.
Yes. In the equation 6, it is explicitly shown the mass mixing between neutrinos and neutrinos. This first mass entry is the full neutralino mass matrix, which is not from the NSSM. And this small m are showing the mixing which is produced from the superpotential terms themselves, and also terms which arise from this neutrino waves and the mixing, and the one can produce a mixing between leptons and neutralinos. This mass matrix can be diagonalized in principle by blocks in the same fashion as it is performed in the system mechanism. And we are up to the equation 7, which is showing the an effective mass matrix for neutrinos, which in this case will be actually neutrinos, gauge neutrinos as we know, plus in a linear combination with neutralinos. But it is a small piece of neutralinos which is included here. In this case, this matrix depends on the soft parameters of the which are included in the neutralino mass matrix, and also a special linear combination between the epsilon parameters and the neutrino waves give rise, and that we call the alignment parameters, or in this case they are labeled with the capital lambda. From simple inspection, one can see that this mass matrix has just one eigenvalue, and in order to fit with this model the phenomenology of neutrino oscillations, we need at least two. So, we are almost forced to consider quantum corrections, which will give rise to small neutrino-massless compounds. The quantum corrections written in a basis where the neutrinos and neutrinos are diagonal at 3-level is summarized in the equation 9. This matrix is encoding all the contributions from the quantum corrections, which came from Yukawa and Gage couplings. And in here, we have the added effect of down quarks and down quarks, up quarks and up quarks, neutralinos and neutral scalars, and neutral pseudo scalars taken jointly. And the corresponding contribution from a Chargino and a W boson and a neutralino, well, neutralino and a neutrino actually, and a Z boson. By performing a similar procedure as it has been performed with the 3-level mass matrix, one can diagonalize this matrix perturbatively. And so we arrive to the equation 11. In here we have truncated that to order g to the sixth, g being the coupling. But in principle, you may truncate up to order g squared. And regardless the order, where are you truncating this expansion, you will realize that there is a special structure made of the bilinear quality violation parameters, which appears from this expression, and it is given by the equation 12. And in this case, we are that special expansion is considering corrections for the 3-level mass, and this other structure appears exclusively at loop level. And well, this epsilon with a tilde, there are special non-linear combinations between the epsilon parameters and the lambda parameters, as the parameters we have shown above. But more importantly, this new structure is showing that we will have another new neutrino mass eigenvalue.
So in other words, okay, coefficient A, B, and C, A is explicitly given at the 3-level. B and C depends on the loops.
It doesn't depend exclusively in the 3-level. It may have quantum corrections.
It can be generalized somehow.
Yes.
So
like there are contributions that that there are whole loops which just contribute to this guy, mm-hmm. not to this, not to those guys.
But the point is that the degeneracy will be generally lifted because the epsilon tilde is not parallel to the 3-level contribution. So
well, when you may choose a basis when they are parallel, but you are not solving the problem. In principle, we don't have any reason to consider further terms in this expansion because this term is compatible to two loop effects. In fact, it is g4th. And this term is actually g6th, and it is three loop effect. But actually, these terms arouse just because of the diagonalization procedure we are using here. Not because we have introduced one particle reducible diagrams. And the only way we have to neglect these terms is if they are numerically irrelevant.
D so stands for diagonal?
D, yes, sorry. This stands for diagonal. In this case, we are working in the 3-level diagonal basis. In this sector, we have the neutrino, the neutrino sector diagonalized at 3-level. And here we have the neutralino sector diagonalized at 3-level. And quantum corrections and in here we are following the same notation.
So when you choose the finiteness or non-finiteness of the quantum corrections, When you had a zero, the three level.
Well, you mean
actually the connections will be fine.
But the problem is, you talk about the perturbative limit in so far you are adding one particular observer diagrams at all orders. But in this case, you are just considering one report.
No, this is not a question, but Jose's question is slightly different. That is, when you calculate one loop convections, you usually get contributions which give you finite parts of the integral, and there's another part which is the infinite part of the loop integral. Now, if you have no non-zero eigenvalue at three level, you expect that only the finite part of the one loop convection survives. Whereas if there is a finite value already at three level, infinite convections can survive.
Which require normalization.
Which require normalizations. So, as far as I understand the problem, your coefficient C, which arises entirely at one loop, has only the finite piece, whereas the piece A, which is renormalizing a quantity which is present at three level, has both finite and infinite pieces.
Yes. Yeah. Good question.
Also B may have infinite, I guess, absolutely.
Yes, also B probably.
No, B has no contribution to zeros. If this is flavor independent, then this has to be finite.
Yeah, B can be reabsorbed probably in C. Yeah, there'll be infinite.
No, I mean that the entry 1,3, for example, has to be finite. Because it was 0 at 3-level.
Yeah.
And B is the same for
all players. That sense probably.
It is global, then it has to be fine.
I guess one has to check, but yes.
Okay. And I was taking the problem here, or at least I wanted to show. And it is about how can we have a feeling about how large are those pieces. And for that purpose, we performed a numerical experiment which consists of first just taking the three-level mass metrics of galileans and neutrinos, plug the quantum corrections, put the thing in a computer, and the neutrino oscillation physics is thrown out. That is in this table is shown in the first column. Second thing, as we wanted to compare the relevance and the importance of the expansion, we take just a piece which contains the three-level neutrino mass matrix plus the g squared order. And it is put, and also we have performed the neutrino oscillation physics with that approximation, and it is put in the second column. And afterwards, the same procedure is done, but just taking the whole expression shown in the question 11, neutrino physics is extracted from it, and it is put in the third column. As we can see immediately, the numerical differences are large between the second and the first column, even in orders of magnitude. And
but what does the middle column
mean? The second column?
Yeah.
It means compute your neutrino oscillation physics, but taking these two guys.
Just the first two.
Just the first two.
And what was the first one? The first column.
The first one is order g squared. The first column is this guy full in a computer and diagonalized. Mm-hmm. And we see that we recover the precision in the calculation if we consider the whole expression. And this means that if we want an approximation for the exact population, not just numerically, but also algebraically, we have to consider the whole expression, which includes g squared and the six terms. But to have one point in the parameter space is not enough. We perform the same analysis for a sample of points in the parameter space, which also are compatible not just with neutrino oscillation physics, but also with collider physics and the measured value of Higgs mass. And it is plotted in a plane with mu and tan beta, but the axes in this case are irrelevant. The relevant point is to watch the spread of the points in a plane. Why do we want to see a cloud of points?
What are the colors?
Slowly. let's go slow. And in this case, we are comparing the exact calculation. We have called this stuff of taking just the whole neutrino, neutralino mass matrix and put that in a computer and diagonalize it. And this value has compared with the approximation we have taken from the expression including the higher order corrections. That thing has been performed for all the neutrino oscillation quantities, and in this case we are showing just the ratio corresponding to the solar square mass difference. In this case we expect, or we expected, that the ratio between both calculations lie around 1 plus some spread. The larger is that spread, the worse will be our approximation. And if a point performs a ratio gives us a ratio which falls in the window we are opening, it is painted in pink. Otherwise, it is painted in purple to give us a measure about how good or bad is our approximation. In that sense, we have fixed these windows up to the values of 1%, 1 plus 1%, 0.1%, 1%, 2%, and 5%. It is clear that insofar we are opening the spread, more points will fall in the values we are allowing us.
So all that I learned from this part is that the approximation simplifies.
Yes, that's the conclusion you have said.
So 25%, almost all the points are included.
And moreover, if you open that spread always less to a 10%, all the points are painted in pink, which means that up to a 10% the approximation works good. And if you want to do these same plots with the approximation which includes the g squared part, you will have all the points painted in purple up to a 50%. Which means that you can't rely neither numerically nor algebraically in that approximation.
Which is that approximation?
The other approximation that I'm referring is g squared.
You needed the seesaw contribution.
Yes. And this plot,
which I guess it makes sense because the three seesaw is at three level. And the first one is loop, so somehow saying that the three levels is bigger than the loop.
Well, in this case, we wanted to perform a further step and another approximation. Or the calculation has been taken in order to prove if we want neglect the upsub correction for, from the full pack of expressions. And in this case, The ratio we have performed is an approximation which considers to remove the upside correction from the world pack, and it is compared with the calculation we have named as full. We see in here that up to a 5% to remove the upside loop is a bad approximation. And also, if we open that that window up to a 10%, it keeps being a bad approximation in general. So if you want to gather as much precision, accuracy as you want, you will have to consider also upside correction. Conclusions for this first part. Well, we have seen that if you want to have a good agreement between your calculation and your numerical algebraic predictions, you are almost forced to consider higher order effects. And almost off the record, it was shown also in that work that the tangent unit of the scalar are always the most important contribution, which has been.
I guess the main is bottoms bottom.
Yeah, the main is bottoms bottom in the most of the cases. But there are some exactly. Points in the parameters, but that's it's almost a rule of thumb. It's not an exact statement. Nevertheless, as it has been stressed a lot, we have no one particular irreducible diagrams in this work. So a comparison between two loop one particular irreducible diagrams and our G4th approximation is urgent. And before putting the hands in that comparison, we also wanted to understand how is working the gauge invariance in this case. But in principle, it has been tested numerically. But we want to also understand it, how is it working algebraically, if we can. Don't just numbers could tell the truth. As you may see, these both calculations are quite straightforward. Nevertheless, they are awful. And that work has been started, but it is going ahead with slow steps. Well, I will also fastly show this part of the because this is a model which is at least for Jose Marco Alberto is not missing here, but it is a more or less well known model, so I will review it as fast as I can. Well, if we could define in some way the scotogenic model and the modifications of it that are available in the literature, we may define them as models where neutrino masses are relatively generated, but this mechanism is mediated by the dark matter candidate. A very important ingredient of this kind of models is the inclusion of an exact set to symmetry which has a multiple role. Firstly, it provides you a good dark matter candidate because it kinematically forbids the lightest particle to decay. Also, if you have to include new scalars that are charged with this symmetry, they cannot acquire pairs. And therefore, since you want an exact set to symmetry, it is the ultimate responsible of writing neutrino masses. Historically, Ernest Mach has proposed two of these models, one which includes at least two generations of single fermions, and other one that includes at least two generations of fermion triplets, and
to generate two scales at the three level.
Yes.
Of neutrino mass. Yes. Sorry, not at the three level. To generate two scales through the loop.
That's true. And well, he has proposed the singlets and the neutral part of the triplets to act as the dark matter candidates, even as the second Higgs in the two Higgs double model. But in principle, it's just an election. That's not important. But this one is the kind of diagram you have when you have this kind of models. This diagram summarizing both models during this internal leg, you may put either a singlet or the northern part of the triplets. In here, it is highlighted the role of the new scalars of the theory. In this case, we are showing the neutral scalar part and the neutral pseudo scalar part of that new doublet. And important also is the role of this coupling in here, because if it is not present, the contributions of these two guys will vanish because of the degeneracy of the masses of these two guys won't be broken. So it is necessary to include a lambda 5 coupling as a distance.
Was this model already in the paper by Ma in 1998? Was already there?
The loop was there, but the central symmetry was not.
The loop was there.
And the Z2 is crucial because it makes the mass radiative, otherwise it has a three level mass.
Let's go to Chen Yi Ping in the paper which was later. The 98 paper only has the loop no
symmetry.
It actually does not work without the symmetry.
In the 98 paper, there is no doubt. It's just that Alice Ma later realized to just put the Z2. Now becomes what's done. But this was later.
Okay.
Five.
Yeah, more or less like
five,
there.
Exactly, that one, 2005.
And in principle, the issue we wanted to explore was, well, the neutral singlet dark matter candidates have a very constrained parameter space which forced the dark matter to be in the order of the 100 GeV and even below. And on the other hand, since the triplet fermion had a charged companion, that companion forced, because of the strong presence of annihilation channels for that dark matter, forced the mass level to be in the order of the 2.3 TeV. So the idea was, well, how can we mix both effects by filling the blank of mass between them? And this can be achieved by just taking one generation of singlets and one generation of triplets. But the cost we pay is that we have to include an additional scalar triplet, which one must allow it to include a bed. So this new scalar triplet, which is on the table here, must be charged even under the Z2 symmetry. And therefore, in here is are the quantum numbers of the particles of the model, and also the most of the particles of the model. The quarks are also included, but they don't play any role up to this moment, but they will play eventually when we performed when we computed the target detection prospects, which, in parentheses, there are no prospect for direct detection for no one of the former models. And in order to test how well aspect, good aspect is our model, we perform this plot, which is showing the relic abundance as a function of the dark matter mass. And the black line is showing the measured value of the relic density at some time, and the colors are showing how is the mixing? Is a way to parameterize the mixing between singlet and triplet. The bluer is the color, the more singlet it is, the redder is the color, the more triplet it is. We seem to thought that in the sum of a few GeV, 100 GeV, the cloud is dominated by blue color, which is good because it is telling us about that we have we have reproduced the former MAM model in this zone, and this accumulation of points around 2 TeV. We also perform performed the MAM model with this one. We notice that ranging from, I don't know, bluish green up to reddish brown colors, we have different mixings of dark matter in between, which means that our object type can be fulfilled in this case. Now, and as a further step, we will focus on the points that are falling upon this black line. And we wanted to explore the production mechanisms of each of them. And therefore, we are from a plot which is of the annihilation cross section as a function of the dark matter mass. The colors stand for the same. And in the yellow line, we are showing the limit of the annihilation cross section given by a WIMP dark matter candidate, which is a particle which is produced just with annihilations. The limit, this is the WIMP, this is the WIMP miracle.
Okay, just to fix the...
Yes, just to fix the ideas how our model is behaving.
But another
different...
Another comparison one could make would be with the detectability prospect of actual experiment, like Fermi.
Well, actually, there's a plot about that, but I won't show it in here, just for the sake of the time. And in this part, we see that mostly the annihilation processes are enough in order to produce dark matter single light. And so far, we are approaching to the tera-electron volt zone, which is the triplet light zone. We see this fall.
So does that mean
that means that in here the co-annihilation channels become important because we are turning on the triplet mode, where the co-annihilation channels become important because of. We are realizing the MAM model, where the charged component of the triplet plays precisely a role of being the co-annihilating channel of the dark matter. And above the 1 electron volt, there are another different channels present, but I really, really don't know what it is.
The question is, which are the points that are physically acceptable of this whole cloud?
Well, that was a feature that was not presented in our former work.
So, looking here, it gives the impression that you have this hybrid dark matter behaving like a wimp, either for the 2 TeV value of Ernest Mach, or if it is mainly singlet with for masses of very narrow, of a few GeV. And everything else, it does not behave as wimp. But I guess it doesn't mean that it is ruled out. Simply does not behave like me. What is the?
It does not behave like me in the sense that the annihilation cross section is smaller than this typical limit. But this does not mean that you cannot have the correct relic density because the points will fill the relic density.
That's what I want.
Actually, this plot is computed with only points that are falling upon the black hole. All of these points are allowed by experimentation.
That's what I want. Now, the other thing which is relevant is within what subregion of that you get a detectable signal for Fermi, for example. That is the other thing.
And that feature is presented
in our paper. Okay. I just don't remember.
But nevertheless, a point which is underlying in your comment is that this model is not fully explored. And that is one of the main conclusions of this work, that this is not explored.
When you say quantifications here, you mean M1 and 2, or what type of quantifications you have in this? Or M with the scalars?
No, in general, the channel with the charted component of the triplets is the main.
Sigma
but you may have other conjugation channels. Well, you know that insofar you have a degeneracy between the masses of the dark matter candidates, you will have a conjugation channel present, or at least.
You see, the dark matter has a piece of the sigma zero, but they form a triplet. So the mass of the sigma zero is close to the mass of the plus and the minus, charged ones. So those help to make speed up the annihilation somehow.
But you can also have annihilation with the fermions, in principle.
Yeah, but you need a very close degeneracy, and here it comes from the symmetry. For the fermions, it's just
put it by hand.
Coincidence.
You put it by hand. So the sigma is a fermion.
I mean, with the right-hand neutrinos, with the N.
With the N,
Well, the main conclusion is that, well, a large mass range and also probably more phenomenology for this model is achieved, but nevertheless, it is not fully explored yet. So, this was the other motivation.
For example, flavor violating processes.
Is into Lepton flavor violation, it's not included in our case, and also we have not studied the scalar potential as a whole. We don't know how it behaves. How is the stability?
Averino started looking at the Lepton flavor violation with Paulina.
I used something.
Well, that's a good start, anyways. Well, that's what was of the main motivations of showing this is to invite you to work in it. And finally, and just closing, closing remarks, the other things that I'm working in. Firstly, I am finishing a paper about Spring Susi, and I won't refer anymore to it. Also, one of the main works that I am performing with Roberto and Felix is a study about Cp violation in order to give rise to a mass for the Majorant without going to this darkest quantum gravity mechanisms. Also, and more baby work than the previous one, is a work where we have a model with one singlet, well, one star singlet, one star doublet, and one star triplet, and some of them are charged under a Lepton number, and we have a Majorant, but we naturally have scenarios where one of the Higgs particles is not allowed to decay into Majorants, which is a scenario of Majorant suppress, in order to be in agreement with the invisible set boson decay. In principle, this model claims to solve also neutrino physics, and well, the other feature that this model has is the presence of a fermion-forming Higgs, but it is not strange because in triple models in general, models have fermion-forming Higgs. Well, in principle, this, as I was saying, this model claims to solve neutrino physics, but it is not well defined the mechanism how it solves that thing, and in principle it can be the mechanism which is presented in the paper can be combined with the photogenic mechanism in order to have a mixed dark matter scenario which on the one hand, a matter like dark matter, and on the other hand, to have the dark matter allowed by your scattering mechanism, both in one moment. Another work, even babier than the previous, is the decoupling of heavy degrees of freedom, in principle, to apply to a model where the first two generations of scalars are heavy in supersimple, in the context of the MSSM. Well, but in principle,
even selectrons, selectrons, and muons,
all
the quarks of the first two generation, but not the third.
Okay. Yes.
So the third one is light, and the other two are heavy. For the spherons, it's the other way around, opposite to the spherons.
Yes. Okay. This model is claimed. That's why we call that model of inverted hierarchy. Mm-hmm. And the idea is to study in software what decouples the particles. To study the interplay with neutrino physics by adding bilinear violating terms, and we want to study the effects of the running cavities in this case. And even bigger than the previous one is a model of quantum gravity, which is made in order to be a, here I put plastic, but I don't know exactly how it says in English. It is a deformable model. In order to have a model where one tests those dark scale mechanisms of quantum gravity which are affecting the particle physics. For instance, the masses for myons, neutrino masses, and there are others. And, well, one can also study processes of inflation by including a Higgs doublet, and in principle we are studying this case with a guy from Chile which works in gravity. And I think last but not the least, I think the main work that I have to do, really totally regardless of the papers that I can publish, is learning physics. That's why we are here. And I don't know almost anything about effective field theory, topological excitations, anomalies with theory, thermal field theory, speed violation, cosmology, dark matter, phenomenology, collider physics. So I just want to know. That's my main task here. I got Edmund, Joseph, Martin for their support and for allowing me to give this talk. Roberto for his support in my previous stay and during this stay. When we went to Chile, to Marco Diaz, a man who I owe almost everything, and Maximiliano Rivera, and all of you for coming. Thank you.
Sorry, we have questions. No questions.
Questions?
Must do that.
Well, later.
Yeah, we have
a meeting at 12:05.
Something like that.
A gentle question.